Click the bell icon to get latest videos from Ekeeda.
Hello friends, how are you? Here we will discuss about the problem that is the mathematical aspect of the amplifier. Here we have chosen the amplifier which is nothing but Cascode amplifier with BJT. We will take one example which has been asked in your Mumbai University, one of the Mumbai University question paper for semester number 4 or 3 maybe, and that is of year May 2016, right? So let's come to this particular circuit and we'll try to analyze this circuit and sort out all the findings. Here, the circuit is in front of you. R1, R2, R3 are nothing but the base resistance for two transistors, that is Q1 and Q2. Q1 is input stage CE amplifier and Q2 is nothing but the transistor which is used for stage 2, that is nothing but CB stage of output stage of multistage amplifier. So whatever the circuit which has been given, you have to identify that it is the given circuit is Cascode amplifier, that is nothing but CE common emitter and common base, CECB multistage amplifier, and that is called as the Cascode amplifier with BJT. So let's quickly get what are the given values. So R1 is equal to 58.8 kilo ohm, R2 is equal to 33.3 kilo ohm, R3 is equal to 7.92 kilo ohm, RC is equal to 7.5 kilo ohm, RS, that is the source resistance which is placed before the coupling capacitor CC1, that is nothing but 1 kilo ohm, RE is equal to 0.5 kilo ohm, RL, that is the load resistance which has also been given after the coupling capacitor CC2, which is nothing but 2 kilo ohm, beta1, beta2 is nothing but the current gain for transistor Q1 and Q2 respectively having same value. I can say that it's nothing but 100 value, and we have to obviously find out the value which are nothing but the voltage gain, that is also called as a small signal voltage gain, and the B part is upper 3 dB frequency. Upper 3 dB frequency is nothing but the higher cutoff frequency FH that we have to find out, but for the upper cutoff frequency we need to have the value of the capacitances that are nothing but the intrinsic capacitances. Here we have the value C pi and C mu. Note that whatever we have discussed is all about the stray capacitance. So namakaran we all have given regarding to the your terminals of bipolar junction transistor. So for example, the coupling capacitor, stray capacitor between base and collector is nothing but CBC, B for base and C for collector. But here we have got some different parameters, that is nothing but C pi and C mu. So C pi is nothing but the coupling capacitor CBE. Note that whatever R pi model we have considered, that R pi is in between base and emitter. That's why whatever capacitor gets formed parallel to R pi, that we also called it as C pi. So that's why C pi is nothing but CBE. Also, the C mu is called as the capacitor which gets formed between the base and your collector side. So it's nothing but CBC. Okay, so now you are very much familiar how to find out higher cutoff frequency. Now I can easily find out higher cutoff frequency because we all know that now C pi is nothing but CBE and C mu is nothing but CBC. Let's move to the finding of all this numerical. Let's move to the first step, that is nothing but the DC analysis. So why do we require DC analysis? The straightforward method is, I know that the value of voltage gain depends on the value of GM, and the GM value is depends on the DC analysis. So first of all, we'll have to find out what will be the value which we are getting from DC analysis. We will not move completely around your DC analysis. Rather than that, we just find out, we just touch to the parameters. Those are very much important for the finding perspectives. Okay, so your first step is step number one, DC analysis. Okay, as far as I know that voltage gain is concerned, what is the voltage gain for a Cascode amplifier? As far as Cascode amplifier is concerned, we all know that this is your AC analysis of Cascode amplifier. So first of all, we have to draw the fundamental AC equivalent model of the Cascode amplifier. Then we'll get to know that what will be the value of voltage gain. But as I said earlier, DC analysis is very important. So we'll do that DC analysis first. We'll calculate, grab the value of GM1 and GM2, and then we'll move further to find out what will be the value of RPi1, RPi2, and so on. So for this particular small signal analysis, we will move towards the DC analysis. So we will say so as far as DC analysis is concerned, we first of all find out the value of VB1 and VB2. I know that what's the value of VB1? VB1 is nothing but, let's say this is Q1 and this is Q2. So we'll be getting VB2 over here and we'll be getting VB1 over here. So value of VB1 is nothing but, we'll directly write this particular resistor divided by the resistances of all these values and multiplied by this 12 volts, that is nothing but the VCC. As VE is equal to 0, we'll directly write VCC. So we'll say this is nothing but 7.92K divided by 33.3 plus obviously K plus 7.92K plus 58.8K the whole multiplied by 12 volts. So calculate this particular value. Hold on, just write, I have just written this formula. Next, I will write the formula as VB2, and that is nothing but the value is equal to 33.3 plus 7.92 divided by 33.3 plus 7.92 plus 58.8. Here I have not written the value in terms of kilo, because numerator and denominator, both the values will become kilo, and kilo kilo ke mar dega. As far as numerator and denominator is concerned, I will be getting the value. This is nothing but the VB2, and that you have to calculate with your CalCE. So check your CalCE is working or not, right? And pause your screen, calculate the value of VB1 and VB2, and again immediately come to me. VB1 is nothing but 0.95 volts, 4.95 volts is value of VB2. So far we have got the value of VB1 and VB2. Now we have to discuss about what will be the value of IE, that is nothing but the whole current which is flowing through Cascode amplifier. As I said that IB1 and IB2 I'm neglecting in this particular case, and I'm saying that the current IE1 is equal to IE2 is equal to IC1 is equal to IC2 is nothing but the value IC. So we will say that the value of, apply KVL to loop A. Here we'll say that apply this loop A. I can say that this VB1 is equal to VBE1 plus this IE into RE. So we will say that the VB1 is equal to VBE1 plus IE into the RE value, that is a 500. So all the values are known to me. See to it that the value of VBE is not given. If it is not given, you have to directly take it as 0.7. If it is of silicon mentioned, if it is not mentioned that is the type of silicon, then you directly take it is as silicon. Assume that it is of silicon transistor only, and we have to take the value of VBE is equal to 0.7 only. So we will take the value 0.7. So 0.7 plus IE, that is unknown parameter, and 500, VBE1 that is known to me 0.95. Now immediately calculate the value of IE. Here value of the IE is very very less, and that is coming out to be IE is equal to 0.5 milliampere. So this is the first value that I have got from DC analysis, which is important for the AC perspective, output gain perspective. Now why it is important for this IC AC analysis perspective? See to it that I know that the value of GM, what is the GM? I can say that GM1 is equal to GM2. Why it is equal? Because as current is equal, then I can say that the value of small RE also equal, and this is nothing but 1 upon RE1, or you can say RE2. So that is same because current is same, and as I know that as RE1 is equal to VT divided by IE1, and IE1 is nothing but the whole current. IE1 is equal to IE2 is equal to IC1 is equal to IC2 as far as these calculations are concerned. So we will get the value of RE1, that is nothing but 26 millivolts, that is VT, divided by IE1, that is 0.5 milliampere. So the value of RE1 is high, so it's, we can say that it's nothing but 52 ohm. This is the value of RE1, and if I take the inverse of this RE1, we will be getting the value of GM1 is equal to GM2 is equal to inverse of 52, 19.23 millimho. That will be your first parameter, I can say, which will be taking part into the AC analysis. So here I can say that equation number 1, which is the last step for your DC analysis. So as far as DC analysis is concerned, we will stop here. We can calculate the value of VCE1, VCE2 as well, but that is not important for this particular numericals. So jitna pucha hai, utna hi karo. Let's move towards the second step, that is step number 2. I can say that we will apply AC analysis. Obviously, as far as AC analysis is concerned, we have to keep two things in your mind. All coupling capacitors and bypass capacitors short circuit, and all DC sources short circuit. So these two things are very important as far as AC analysis is concerned. Now we will draw the AC equivalent model. So our fine job is depends on this AC equivalent model only. Let's start with the first BJT. We will say this is your RPi 1, this is your GM1, VGS, VPi, it's not BJT, it's not FET, VPi 1. This is your first BJT. After first BJT, we'll say that we'll take this is your base 1, this is your emitter 1, this is your collector 1. Base is connected with two resistances. See to it that if I am using the AC analysis, then I can say that this will be short circuited, this will be also getting short circuited. So RS will be connected to the base of first Q1, and then will connect the value of VI. So I can say that the first two resistances will come into picture. This R2 is getting connected from the ground to base B1, and from base B1 to ground another resistance is also there, that is R3, as VEE and VCC both are grounded for AC analysis. So we will say that the first resistance that will be connected in parallel, I can say, with RPi 1, that is nothing but, we will do the namakaran for this as RB1, and another resistance is obviously will take part here, and that is nothing but RS, and then we will be getting the value VI. Let's move ahead for the second transistor. Mind well that the second transistor ka source is connected to the collector of the first transistor. So here we will say that the second transistor is connected from here. So we will take this particular. Clear? Fine. Okay. So as far as this second transistor is concerned, we reached up to GM2 V pi 2, and this is your R pi 2, and this is your value V pi 2. We again will do the namakaran for second transistor, that is B2 and E2 and C2, and then we will start drawing few resistances that were left out as RC and RL. So both of them are in parallel. So this is your RL and this is your RC. Clear? Now let's see how we will be getting the value VO. Clear? See, what we'll have to do. Do we require the AC analysis part for this particular numerical? No, not really. So basically what we'll have to do, we'll have to take the particular formula from your analysis part. So we'll take that particular formula from analysis part. So as far as this particular formula is concerned, we have done this AC analysis, and here we have got the value of VO divided by VI is equal to minus GM2 into RC. But hold on, we have the source resistance as well. So keep this in mind that whenever we have done this particular analysis, let's see to it that this particular AC equivalent model was without any source resistance. So here we have to take some another step beyond this particular formula so that we will be getting the value of VO divided by VS, that is expected value of voltage gain for this particular numerical. So we'll do another namakaran for this particular VI. We'll say that this is VS, okay, and we'll say here it is VI. So whatever gain that is given in the formula perspective, that is nothing but your GM1 into RC. Moreover, here RC only given, RL was not given, so we have to consider the RL into picture, that is nothing but the series, a parallel combination with RC. So we will say that the first of all voltage gain that we'll be getting, one part I left out, that is nothing but here I have to connect this as grounded because the bypass capacitor is there and capacitor we are taking it as short circuit connection. So here voltage gain that is expected, AV is equal to VO divided by VS, and that is nothing but VO divided by VI into VI divided by VS. So our job is to split the particular voltage gain into two parts. From one we'll get from formula, one ratio, first ratio we'll get from formula, and second ratio we will be getting from the one of the five fingers, that is nothing but suppose I have the value of VI, but I want the ratio of VI by VS, then obviously which five finger I have to apply? I have to apply VDR, that is voltage divider rule. So if I consider the value of VS as total voltage, and that is getting divided into two resistances which are connected, RS and RB1. So rather RB1 only I don't have to consider, I have to consider this complete input resistance as RB1 and RPi as well. So I can say that here I will apply VDR. So we'll shortly calculate this particular values. First of all, we'll take the value of VO divided by VI. I will say that we'll get the direct formula as GM1 into, instead of RC, I have to say that RC parallel RL. Very good. Calculate this particular value, and again, we will move ahead to the calculation of second ratio, that is nothing but the VDR. Apply VDR at input. If we are applying VDR at input, we will be getting the ratio, that is nothing but VI divided by VS is equal to, and that ratio will be nothing but RB1 in parallel with R pi 1 divide by RB1 in parallel with R pi 1 plus RS. Okay, and this is the ratio. This is the first formula and this is the second value we'll be getting, and we'll have to take the product of this, and that is nothing but your voltage gain. So quickly calculate both these values and we'll consider this product as your voltage gain. We have got the value of minus 30.36 as VO divided by VI. Now the question arises, how to calculate the value of R pi 1, because R pi 1 is not given, but the value of beta is given and we have got the value of Re 1 as well, and we know that the relation between the beta and Re 1, beta Re 1 is nothing but the R pi 1. If we interrelate the particular models, that is not, that are nothing but the R pi model, Re model and H parameter model, these things will be very very simple for you. So let's see that this R pi 1 is nothing but beta into Re. So as Re value is nothing but 52 ohm and beta value is 100. So with this particular calculation we'll be getting the value of R pi 1. We already have the value of RB1. RB1 is nothing but, what will be the value of RB1 that we have to consider? That RB1 is nothing but R2 parallel R3. We don't have to consider the value of R1 because both the terminals of R1 are getting attached to the ground, so it becomes redundant now for AC analysis. So we'll calculate quickly this particular value, we'll put this values in this particular formula VI divided by VS, and again we'll go through this particular product to get the value of voltage gain. Here I can say that it becomes 2.8686 divide by 2.8686 and the value of RS which is given as 1K. Obviously this is value of in terms of K, so here we will be getting 0.7415. See to it that as I am connecting the value of source resistance, I have got the reduced value of voltage gain. So whatever voltage gain I'm getting, that will be in the form of reduced voltage gain. If we are not connecting that signal resistance, that is our signal, our source, then I will not get the reduced value of voltage gain. So we have got the value, these two values, and we will get the voltage gain. Minus 30.36 multiplied by 0.7415. So here we will be getting the value 22.51. That is nothing but the first parameter that we have got for this particular numerical. Okay, let's move out to the second part of this particular numerical as far as finding is concerned. So we have to go for the step number 3. That is nothing but the high cutoff frequency. We'll say that it's nothing but high frequency response. As far as high frequency response is concerned, we have to calculate the value of FH. So we will again discuss the cutoff frequencies. For the high frequency response, I will quickly write the formulas based on the high frequency response. We have done the analysis in earlier videos, so just go through that particular videos, you will get to know that how to calculate the value of FH1, FH2 and FH3. So I'll write directly the formulas of FH1 over here. FH1 is equal to 1 upon 2 pi RC, whereas R is equal to, here we have to consider that value of R as RB1 in parallel with R pi 1. Now here we have to consider the value of RS. I will parallelly draw that particular RC network here. This is your RS. This is your RB1. This is your R pi 1. R pi 1. RB1, and we don't have to consider this particular circuit, we have to consider the high frequency response. So we'll again redraw this circuit. It's my mistake. We will say that we'll be getting, first of all, CBE, that is nothing but C pi which is given in your numerical. So we'll write right now CBE. Then your CMI1, what is CMI1, we'll get to know shortly. We'll have to calculate the value of CMI1, and this is obviously connected to your things, and then we have to connect this, your source resistance RS, that will become in parallel combination. So as far as high frequency is concerned, that will be getting in parallel with RS, that is source resistance. So ultimately R value is nothing but RB1, RPI1 and RS. As far as C value are concerned, I have not purposely written the value of CWI because CWI is not given in your numerical. So only two capacitances will be there in your numerical, that are nothing but CBE and CMI1. So here we will take the value of CMI1 as plus CBE and CMI1 addition, that is nothing but the value of CM. So first of all, we'll have to calculate the value of CMI1. We will calculate it quickly. 1 minus AV1 multiplied by the value of CBC. Very simple. So see to it that what will be the value of AV1? See, just now we have considered the AC equivalent model here. In this particular AC equivalent model, we have got that what is the value of this particular first AV1. We'll quickly revise your analysis part. In this analysis part, we have done the stepwise calculation. Here we have got the value of VO and VI, and then VO and VPI2. So we have got the value of VPI2 divided by VPI1. So see to it that what is the value of VPI2? So basically VPI2 is nothing but the value of this, is the value. So this is the output voltage of the first transistor, and this is your input voltage of the first transistor. We don't have to consider this VS, we have to consider this VI, because base and collector ke beech mein ye capacitor hai. So we have to consider this particular gain only, we don't have to consider this particular gain. So let's come to the point that we want to have the ratio of, let's say, VY and VX. So VY by VX is nothing but the voltage gain as far as the Miller's capacitance is concerned. So this voltage is nothing but VO1. I can say that VPI2, but in negative form. So negative VPI2 divided by this is nothing but your VPI1. So already we have got the ratio of VPI2 divided by VPI1. We'll calculate the value of this particular AV1 is equal to VPI2 divided by VPI1. So whatever value you will be getting, that we have to consider it as your, this is nothing but your minus VPI2 divided by VPI1, that is nothing but your output voltage. So let us see to it that whatever value, this particular value you have got. So as far as beta is concerned, GM1 and RPI2 is concerned, we have know that ki GM into RPI is nothing but the value of beta. And here GM1, GM2 is equal RPI1, RPI2 is equal. So I can say that it's nothing but beta divided by 1 plus beta is nothing but the value of VPI2 divided by VPI1. So whatever gain that I'm getting is nothing but beta divided by 1 plus beta. And that is very, very nearly equal to 1 only. So I'm saying that it's nearly equal to 1 only, okay, but it is of value negative. So we'll consider this as negative sign. This is because I know that this value is negative of VPI2, and VPI2 minus VPI2 divided by VPI1 is nothing but minus beta divided by 1 plus beta. So whatever value I'll be getting, that is nothing but -1. So I can say that this comes out to be twice of CBC, and that value we have to incorporate it over here, that is nothing but CMI1 always. So keep this in mind that whatever CMI1 I'll be getting, that will be your twice of CBC. Okay, so now we have the value of this particular as far as this numerical is concerned, we'll get to know that what will be the value of the given value for CPI is CBE. So we'll write that CBE value is 24 picofarad and the value of CMI. CMI 1 is nothing but twice of CBC. CBC is nothing but 3 picofarad. So here we will write that 6 picofarad, that is nothing but twice of CBC, twice of C mu is nothing but CMI 1. So here directly we can say that it's nothing but 30 picofarad. Great. Calculate the value of CB, RB, 1 parallel R pi, 1 parallel RS, and that is coming out to be 864.69. So this is nothing but 864.69 ohm. This is the first value and this is the second value that will give me the value of FH1. So let's see what is the value of FH1 I'm getting. 6.135 megahertz. 6.135 megahertz. That is the first value as far as first RC circuit is concerned. So let's see that this is the first value as far as high frequency response is concerned. I hope you have all clear about this FH1. Let's move to the part of FH2. Here we will do the namakaran of FH1 as the first RC circuit. RC circuit is in between at the input of first stage. Let's move to the part intermediate, that is, let's take the simple one at output of second stage. What will be the formula? So we'll write the general formula first. FH2 is equal to 1 upon 2 pi R and C, and as I know that the value of R is nothing but only two resistances are there, these resistances are nothing but R C in parallel with R L. So this is the value of R. C part is crucial, so let's see to it that what will be the C part. In the C part we have to consider only the value of CBC, and CBC we don't have to consider with Miller's output conversion. This is because this is now output stage is nothing but CB mode. So C, whatever circuit that I'm getting, I'm writing red with resistance, resistance with red rather, and capacitances with blue pen, and yes, finished. So as far as this CBC is concerned, we have know this particular value. RL is known to us and RC also known to us. So put the value and get the answer. Quickly find out the value of FH2. 33.58. So FH2 is equal to 33.58 megahertz. It's a very huge value that I'm getting out of this second RC circuit calculation. So I'll say that this is the second equation, and the third and last part of this particular RC high frequency response is in between stage 1 and stage 2. So in between stage 1 and stage 2 we have to consider what kind of frequency response I'm getting. So that is nothing but what value of R we have to consider. See to it that whatever frequency FH3 I'm getting, that is nothing but 1 upon 2 pi RC. As far as this resistances are concerned, we have to consider this as R pi 2, and that is connected with this ground, whereas this is positive and this is negative. So I'll consider it over here for your V pi 2, and I can say this is your again one resistance. I can consider this as RO1, but usually this RO1 is becomes an infinity stage. But keep this in mind that whatever resistance I'm considering this as R pi 2, that is actually at the base side, but I'm not incorporating this R pi 2 at the base side, but I'm converting it to emitter side. So I'm converting this by changing the value of R pi 2 as R pi 2 divided by beta. So whatever value I'm getting for the resistances, I can say that this resistance is nothing but RO1 in parallel with R pi 2 divided by beta. So whatever value I'm getting, that is nothing but R pi 2 divided by beta, as RO1 is tending towards infinity, or which is not at all given. If it is not given, then you have to assume that it is infinity. What is the value of C? As far as this value of C is concerned, we have to consider the output CCE, which is not given, so don't have to consider. Then the value, which is nothing but CBE, and the value, which is nothing but CMO1. Similar to your input side, I will get the value. This we don't have to consider because it is not given. Okay, so we will not take part into this particular part. So as this is the in between collector and emitter, and the value of CCE is not given, we don't have to worry about that particular value. We will not incorporate that particular value into this value. So CBE plus CMO1 is the parameters that we have to consider. CBE is given, CMO1, oh great, CMO1 that we have to consider. So obviously, as far as CMO1 is concerned, I know that the value 1 minus AV1 ka inverse multiplied by CBC1. As far as CBC is concerned, that is known to us. AV1 is concerned, that is also known to us. So I can say that as AV1 is equal to minus 1. So AV1 inverse, that is also turn out to be minus 1. So minus 1, 1 minus of minus 1 will become 2. So twice of CBC1, that is nothing but the value of CMO1. So here I will also directly write, as we have done in the first RC circuit, that is nothing but twice of CBC1. Okay, so what we'll have to take, twice of CBC1 plus CBE, that is nothing but C. R is equal to R pi 2 divided by beta. Beta is 100 and R pi 2 is nothing but the value of RE into beta. So ultimately RE value is nothing but the value of R over here we have to consider. So put the value of R and C, calculate first value of R and C, and then put the values of R and C into FH3. You will be getting the value of FH3, and this FH3 is coming out to be 102 mega ohm. So it's also great value at the higher side. So whatever FH3 I'm getting is nothing but 102 megahertz. So we have got successfully three values of 3 RC circuit as far as Cascode amplifier is concerned. Now we'll just have to compare all these three values one after another, and we'll have to take the lower value out of these three values. So I can say that higher cutoff value, higher cutoff frequency, that is I can say that FH is equal to minimum out of FH1, FH2, FH3, and this is how we will be getting the value. We'll say minimum FH1 is 33.58 megahertz. Then we have got 6.135 megahertz, sorry, FH2 is 33.58 and this is 6.135 megahertz, all are in terms of megahertz. Then 102 megahertz. So as far as all three values are concerned, I can say this value is very, very less. So we can say whatever FH I'm getting, that is nothing but 6.135 megahertz. So as far as Cascode amplifier characteristics are concerned, we already have mentioned that Cascode amplifier will give you very high bandwidth, and that is, this is nothing but the proof in the numerical. 6.135 megahertz, that is nothing but the higher cutoff frequency, and obviously at lower cutoff frequency you may get at 20 or 30 hertz. So I can neglect the value of FL, so I can consider FH itself as your bandwidth of Cascode amplifier. So as far as this video is concerned, we'll stop here. So we will learn more and more complex circuit along with me, along with Ekeeda videos. So subscribe Ekeeda videos and we'll learn more and more EDC along with me. Thank you so much.